That's it. Keep climbing. All the way up to the very top of Telegraph Hill. Take a seat and stay for a while and enjoy the view. I'm John Lee, Captain John Lee, San Francisco resident since 1864, and ferryboat captain for 37 years out on that bay. Back in the 1890s, I would bring my two daughters up here and tell them about the many ships we could see. They learned a lot about San Francisco and the bay from up here. There have been vessels out there for 10,000 years or more. The first ones were trolley boats. The people living here fashioned those boats from bundles of reeds. They used them for fishing and hunting and travel. Much later, a little packet ship, the San Carlos, entered the Golden Gate around the time of the American Revolution. Aboard were Spanish mapmakers sent from Mexico. That was the beginning of the outside world coming and going through the Golden Gate. Not long after the Spanish mapmakers were here, small ocean-going vessels, brigs, brigantines, or schooners arrived with sea otter hunters. The Russians, the British, and finally the Americans from Boston sailed to China with those pelts, making them the first world traders here. It was a good business, but meant the end of the otters, beavers, and a lot of the seals that populated the bay. By the 1830s and 40s, you would see little barks or brigs that had sailed from Boston around Cape Horn, with Yankees looking to buy cowhides and tallow from the missions and ranches here. They would return to Boston and sell that cargo to New England shoe factories. Yankee crews got to know the area, and some settled here in this quiet town, which was then known as Yerba Buena. When gold was discovered, the quiet times were no more. Gold fever infected folks everywhere, and soon ships from all over the world were streaming through the Golden Gate. When the ships arrived at the harbor, they dropped anchor, and most everybody took off for the gold fields, abandoning hundreds of vessels, many of which are buried below downtown San Francisco to this day. The prospectors wasted little time getting upriver to the gold country. Steam paddle wheel river boats were the best way to get there until the railroad came along. They were expensive to build and operate, but with all that traffic, they made a lot of money. Even as the gold fever cooled off, San Francisco's population grew. All these folks needed goods, hay, fruit, salt, grain crops, moved from the valley farmlands to San Francisco docks. Scow schooners, simple flat-bottomed sailing boats, perfect for the job. Scows were cheap and easy to build. It was a good little business for an individual or a family. Through the years, you could see them making their way up and down the bay. And the fishing boats you could see from this hill. Italians had their feluccas and later their Monterey-type power boats. Any Sunday, you could see them heading out into the bay, then back to the wharf on Thursday, heavy with a catch for Friday's market. The Chinese built little junks out of redwood and used them to net bay shrimp for their shrimp fisheries. As far back as the gold rush, you could spot ocean steamships smoking their way in and out of the bay. Pacific Mail Steamship Company got a government contract to carry the mail in 1848. When their big wooden side wheel steamers came through the gate, the whole city turned out like it was a holiday. Steamer Day, it wasn't. And everyone knew the steamer was coming with mail because of the semaphore signals sent from right here on top of Telegraph Hill. That same Pacific Mail Steamship Company used large ocean liners after the Civil War to carry mail across the Pacific to Japan and China. And generations of Chinese and Japanese immigrants arrived here on the return passages. San Francisco continued to grow, and there was a tremendous demand for lumber. So California shipbuilders made these wide, shallow lumber schooners. Those vessels could get into any of the tiny coastal mill harbors, pick up a load of redwood or Douglas fir timber, then sail down the coast through the gate to the busy docks on the waterfront. We could see them on the bay, heavy with great piles of lumber on their wide, flat decks. And you would always see the big steam ferry boats. What a life it was.
Before the bridges were built,
we carried thousands of passengers, the first commuters here, into town each day and back home every evening. When the fog wasn't too thick, those lucky folks got close views of the schooners, tugs, steamers, all the action on the bay. Ah, but the grandest vessels you could ever hope to see were the big square rivers, like the Vaucluse. After the gold rush, wheat grain was the main cargo export from San Francisco. Those wind-powered ships sailed that cargo around Cape Horn to Europe and returned with imported goods for our growing city. Until about 1900, the big square riggers handled almost all of our deep-water cargo shipping. But the new steel-hulled freighters with oil-fired engines changed all that. Those ships were able to make the passages from Europe to the West Coast efficiently and predictably. Most were built in Great Britain. But America got into building freighters in a big way during the two world wars. There were thousands of ships built right here in San Francisco Bay. It was a perfect fit, with rail lines delivering the raw materials, a big labor force, and an easily accessible waterway for the shipyards. In the 1960s, American companies pioneered the use of containers, but it doomed San Francisco as a port. Container ports need lots of land and good rail and highway connections. Just the ticket for the port of Oakland, which has become one of the largest containerized cargo ports in the West. The vessels out there today still tell a great story. They look different, but like the vessels dating back thousands of years, they use the free waterway of the oceans and bay that connect us to the rest of our world. They are part of your life today, and part of your history tomorrow. Enjoy the view and smooth sailing.